Thank you for attending my session. Some people in the room, maybe it's the first time. Some other people, it's the last time. But anyway, I like to come to Online Etica because you, all the time you need old friends and new friends. And it's like a little bit coming home. So it's like, I never see this as a kind of a keynote. It's keynote, but I'm just one of you telling my story about learning and change and innovation. So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to share you a lot of experience. I'm 61 and a lot of experience. It's 51 slides in 30 minutes, so I better start. So what I'm going to talk about is Red Monkeys and Red Monkey Disruption. This is my Twitter account, so feel free to quit the Twitter. But I'm going to start. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to try to awaken some of you, because everything is changing. And what we have to do is, because people are asking me, is change possible? Yes. Is disruption possible? Yes. And my conclusion is that education doesn't change fast enough, not because it's not possible, but because it's not allowed. And that's the difference. So what I will address today is, why isn't it allowed? And what can you do to make it happen? Because we need another kind of education. So we are going to talk about 2D and 3D. And this is the first question, what is happening? And I try to do that with my own vocabulary. And we are changing the world. It's coming from 2D. And this is where we are coming from. Some people told me, never talk with your back to the audience, but no problem. So this is where we're coming from. And this is a period of information shortage. So this means it's flat and you couldn't learn at home. But now we have an information explosion. And now we have this information explosion and now we can learn at home. So we're not living anymore in information shortage. We are living in information luxury. And what we see today is disruption, chaos and evolution. And we're not used to that. We are used to this. We are not used to that. So what we are experiencing now is a complete switch in how we have to learn and how we have to work. And a lot of people of my age really have problems with that. Because it's going so fast. So what is happening now, and this guy said it, is the origin of species. Today we have a real fight between these groups of people. And maybe it's not age related. But a lot of old people are 2D smarts. And a lot of young people are 3D smarts. But just to understand how this war is fought, we have to understand where we are coming from. And this is where we are coming from. We are coming from industry, which was built around ideas, creative people, and then they started production. And how can you start production? It's easy. You write function descriptions, and you make people with discipline and intelligence to do it. This is 2D smarting. It's just cloning. We clone people. But in order to clone people, we need a dedication. So the function description was translated to diplomas, and you got your diploma if you could clone this, and then went to work. So the whole educational system is based on a reality that is past. We are coming from a cloning system. And education is just a copy machine. And so if you think about that, then you have to realize that what is the result? The result is that 80% of people going to work, they do meh. I also did not do the pre-conference workshop. This is going to be a problem because sometimes in the night I wake up and say meh. My wife says, shut up. So this is happening. Too many people don't have the passion and talent to work because they had to be disciplined and intelligent to do the job. So we have to figure out how can we create a learning environment and a working environment where we are not clones, but where everybody is authentic, where everybody gets in the groove with who he is. So what we have to do is we have to go to another model of learning. And I'm 61 and I never stop learning. What I realize is that my brains don't learn as fast anymore than I was 40 years younger. I walk slower, drinking is the same, but I walk small. but some things you can't do as fast as the younger people. So we have to start a cooperation. So I started thinking about learning. And what is learning? Learning is a physical thing. Because what happens is, if you're passionate about what you learn, then you learn from every source you know. During drinks, during this kind of moment, but also on the internet, streaming video, Donald would say artificial intelligence systems, whatever. It doesn't matter where the information comes. If you are passionate to learn, you want to learn. And what happens is magic. Because if the information goes through your brain, it makes neural connections. This is learning. It's a physical process. It doesn't hurt. Anybody says, no, it doesn't hurt. Learning doesn't hurt. That's the reason we are built to learn. If it would hurt, stop learning. But it doesn't hurt. But whatever it is that, if you're learning, if you're passionate, then your brain lights up. If you go into a PET scanner, you see the areas in the brain where new neural connections are made. But magic happens. It continues. You not only learn when you get information, you also learn when you tell other people information. And this is really what happens with passionate people. Passionate people realize that when they explain something, they are the learner. Because during this learning process, new neural connections are made. And sometimes you tell mistakes. But somebody in the audience tells you you're wrong. It's a learning experience. So what is learning? Learning is giving and taking. So this is one of my basic principles. If you build an educational system, make sure that students also teach. And be part of the ecosystem. Not anymore teacher and student, it's an ecosystem. And the teacher learns from the students, and he's a guide. A guide who is more wiser maybe, but he's a guide. So when I came up with this picture and this thing from the PET scan, I invented a new machine. And this is a machine. I got a 3D printer at home. I printed at home. LEDs from China, engine from China, recoup. And this is learning. So the passion to suffer makes you learn. You inhale information, you got new neural connections. It doesn't stop. And then you explain, and it grows again. And if you're talking about education, we should build a system where people from build on their passion for their talents are in the mood of learning. And maybe you have different talents and maybe different jobs, and then now you learn for talent A or passion one, and then you learn for passion A, but it doesn't stop. Educational system today is this. It's out. And then 2 weeks before the exams, it stays 24 hours in the brain, and then it stops again. And then you give him a degree. this is wrong in the system. So what I'm trying to say is you can't fake learning. You need passion to suffer. Students who are really in the flow with their passion and talent, they suffer. They are a challenge for teachers. They want to learn faster. So what happens is, how come? And what is the impact of these 3D smarts? 3D smarts are so passionate, and the information is increasing. And we need new systems to get the right information at the right time. A lot of people know more about that than I do. But these 3D smarts, they jump into an information flow. They make new associations. This is the symbol of creativity. You wake up with an idea, and then you want to do something with it. So you go find and find resources. You're an entrepreneur. So learning and finding the right means to do it makes you an entrepreneur. And then you change the world with new products and services. And then the other ones start copying it. And this doesn't stop anymore. So what we have to do is, there is no speed limit. And all these things are happening at the same time. And I'm 61 and I don't understand everything anymore. What the fuck is blockchain? I don't understand everything anymore, but I know I don't understand. And this is the first thing about learning. And then you have to get passionate to learn it, what you need. So the thing is, what is the impact? This is the impact. Most of the organizations I know are dying. Why? The light is out. It's easy. So what do we have to do? Well, we have to go to another system. And I'm thinking about what is killing organizations. Is it technology? No. Is it digital? No. Is it AI? No. It's stupidity. Plain stupidity. So I tried another word and I call it the power defect. And what is the power defect? Well, for me, this explains everything. This is wisdom from a guy who suffered a lot. But I found the truth in the word competence. And if you look up the word competence in the dictionary, it says you have to be capable, first condition, and the second condition is you have to be authorized. So if somebody tells me I'm competent, he means I'm capable to do it and I'm allowed to do it. And what is capability? Capability are you're in the flow with your talents, your brain lights up, and you learn every day. And today we have open access to information. This is new. Finally, we can become who we are. Never before we could do that. And if this can happen with artificial intelligence, even better. So you get to the right information at the right time, but you develop your talents and you become competent. But the second thing is somebody has to tell you you're allowed to do it. So I woke up, middle of the night, and I said, how in the hell can I explain this? And I came up with this figure. So what I did is I put over there, are you capable? No. Are you capable? Yes. Are you authorized? No. Are you authorized? Yes. This is the most easy picture for teachers. So if you're there, this means that you're not capable and you're not authorized. This means the light is out and somebody else tells you what to do. That's a 2D teacher. He has a function description. He knows how to do it. And if he wants to do it, he has to ask it 2 times. But what we really need is, in your business, we need teachers who are very capable and authorized to build their own learning environment. And I told some people, I use a chalk. I got streaming video. I got a smart board. This is my classroom. Why? It's my classroom. Nobody's telling me how I have to do it. It's me. If somebody tells me how to do it, get out. I take the authorization. That's why I don't work for a boss. And I think every teacher should do that. You're the boss in your classroom. But we have 2 other situations. And this is bad. Above situation is when you're very capable, but you're not authorized. So you learn, you have the passion, but you're not allowed to do it. You will die. There are only 2 ways of survival. First, you say, okay, then I don't learn anymore. Just tell me what to do and I pick up my salary at the end of the month. Or you're so passionate and talented, you die from a burnout because you don't get reward from what you do. Or you leave the company, and that's brain drain. So if you feel that in your upper left, leave your company. Because you will die before you're on a pension. You will mentally die. But this is worse. These are the people who are not capable, but very authorized. That's your boss. All right. And he is destroying companies because he doesn't even understand. And a lot of people are unconscious incompetent. This means they are happy, but they are still stupid. So what we have to do now, so is how do we solve the power defect? And I've been thinking about that for years. And what I did is I tried to figure it out and I came up with a metaphor. And the metaphor is Red Monkey Innovation Management. My organization is a jungle. And so I started to think about how can we disrupt organizations to survive. And so I picked up this story from continuous improvement or disruptive innovation. And I'll show you a picture. But this is where we're coming from. Continuous improvement. Imagine 20 years ago, somebody of you would have an idea. Can we change a whiteboard in a smart board? There's nothing disruptive about that. So you explain this stuff. Everybody says, yes, 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 yes. Good idea, good idea. And then you go to finance. They said, okay, you have a return on investment. And then this is consensus. In the Netherlands, they call this a polder model. There are Dutch people in the room, I know. Polder model. But that's not how you survive. Today, if you are a 3D smart teacher with passion and talent, you go up and you start giving ideas which are very disruptive. And yesterday I explained one. Maybe a teacher should say to his students, make videos about what I explained, put it on the internet, and next year the next generation of students will learn from you. It's a disruptive idea. Now, if this teacher goes into the educational system, he will have a conflict because he's destroying education as we know. And the second thing is, you can't calculate the return on investment because it isn't proven yet. So everybody starts asking, what's the return on investment? And these people say, I don't know. Now, if you really want to have disruption in education, you have two conflicts. That's where it starts. So it starts really above. Disruption in education starts when not everybody understands the idea and you can't prove the return on investment. So if you think about that, so what do we have to do? And so many years ago, when I was still working for a big company, I went to the ASTD, American Society Training and Development. Somebody has been there in the US? It was for me a mind-opener. And one of the guys talking at that time was Joel Barker. And he was talking about the jungle and the ecosystem. And I still remember that story. So he asked the audience, where do you think the biodiversity in the jungle is coming from? And nobody had an answer. And he said, well, there is a new generation of scientists who said that the biodiversity of the jungle is coming from the edge, not from the middle. So there where the ecosystem crosses with other ecosystem, new ideas are born. This is what today we call fusion. That's what we call open innovation. At that time, these words didn't even exist. That's the reason why most companies now start to network with other companies not in the same ecosystem. So if online Erica would be innovative, this would be more organizations from different sectors coming together to change education. Because the best ideas are not coming from within the company, they're coming from the edge. So I was talking about it and people asked me, but how do you handle conflicts? And I said, well, imagine that you have a brown monkey from the jungle. You see his eyes, passion and talent, really looking for solutions. His brain is really lighting up and he starts talking with a red fish. It took me ages to find the red fish on the internet. I found one. They start talking with red fish from a complete, and they said, Jesus, man, we can make talking movies. So the silent actor says, with this technology, we can make movies who speak. So this brown monkey says, I will call this idea a red monkey. That's where it started. So what happens is, this silent actor runs through the jungle for 1,000 silent actors, and he said, I have an idea. We're going to make talking movies. And you know what happens? Dead. Dead. Why? Because of the power defect. And who are the hunters? The hunters are the red monkey hunters. This is the red monkey hunters. They don't understand. They don't have the capability, but they have the power. And they shoot. So how many teachers are shot with bright ideas? Because other people didn't understand. How many people will leave this conference with ideas who maybe even are afraid to tell in their organization what they should do? And I know from experience, my wife worked in education and she was killed because of peer tutoring many, many, many years ago. And everybody has this experience. And this is not only for education, it's also in industry. I used to work for Siemens. I think in Nokia there has been also someone who said, can we make a phone with this? And he was shot. So what we see is that most organizations die because of the power defect. And the power defect kills people with bright ideas who don't have the power. And most of the time today, it's old against young. I don't say that's a rule, but it's often. So I see a lot of young teachers coming to school, bright ideas, killed, get to a burnout and go to another profession. It's too bad. So what do we have to do? We have to understand red monkey politics. And what is red monkey politics? Whenever you go back to your school and you have a bright idea, you have to realize that within your organization, you have four groups. And the first group is hopefully you, a creator. A creator who is a 3D smart, who has a red monkey, and he throws it in the organization. Okay, that's yours. I got 200 more. Okay, he has an idea, and he is a creator. And then they have a group, so on the left you are the creators, and the aisle on the left side, you are the pioneers. And the pioneers say, Jesus, this is really a disruptive idea. Let's produce videos on online learning with students. Students become part of the teaching process, the learning process. It's an ecosystem. And these pioneers understand the creator because they have the same passion and talent. And you know what bonds these two? They have so much passion and talent, they can imagine something in their head that isn't really there. That's where it starts. So if we bring people together with the same passion and talent, they see, it's like making music before the music is there. It's like an artist making a painting in his head before it's on the painting. And then you have the other group, and the other group I call the followers. That's you. And you, how do you recognize followers? Very easy. They have one question. Does it already work someplace else? Do you have data? Do you have big data? Do you have proof? Is there an artificial intelligence system that says it's okay? It's a joke. But they don't understand. Why? Because they don't have the same passion and talent as the other ones. And then you have the settlers with this you. The people from the old paradigm who got promoted and got a salary and have power. And you're afraid to lose your status. So what do you say? Kill it. Kill it. Or they kill us. So, that's why organizations don't change. So what do we have to do? We have to accept that if we want to disrupt education to something new, to something that really gets the passion and talent from children, we have to go in the conflict mode. And this means that you have to accept that whenever you have bright ideas, disruptive ideas, you will have a fight with the other ones. And this is happening today. This is happening today. More and more. This is killing organizations. And so what do we have to do? So I was trying, when I was writing this book, I was thinking about what is a solution for successful innovation in 3D. And I think I got the answer. We just need brave companies and organizations to implement it. And the first thing is, you have to buy a t-shirt which says, never underestimate the power of stupid people in large groups. Well, you have to do that. And then you put here the logo of your company and here a red monkey. That's merchandise. We can talk about that. And the second thing is, what you never do is, you start with people who don't believe in it. I repeat it. Never start with people who don't believe in it. So if you have a disruptive idea, don't go and develop it with the followers. Don't go and develop it with the settlers. Just giving you an idea. If Dyson, you know, the vacuum cleaner without a bag, if we would come into a company with vacuum cleaners and they said, hey, I got an idea. A vacuum cleaner without a bag. Dead. Right? So imagine that now we have a CEO who says, well, I don't like conflicts. We have to have consensus. So what he does, he says to Dyson, you have to talk with the bag producers in our company. So the bag producers and Dyson go together, and then you don't have a vacuum cleaner without a bag. Because in every vacuum cleaner, there would be a small bag, which is more expensive than the original bag. And that's consensus. That is what's happening now with the electrical car. You have electrical car and got hybrids. So this is something you have to understand. The moment you bring these two groups together, you're not working anymore about innovation. You're working about consensus. It's impossible to do disruption. So what do? To create a culture where you can build educational systems of the future. And this is what I call Red Baron Innovation Management. And I'm adding something which is crowd-driven, because the crowd is so powerful. You have to start using the crowd, which these are people not part of your ecosystem. But the first thing you have to do in order to get it to work, you have to look at your company as a jungle. Imagine every company is a jungle. And imagine you have a CEO or the big boss who has a mission. And it all starts with the mission. And then it starts with storytelling, but authentic. And imagine that your boss in the education system said, we're not a cloning machine. Cloning machine is so 2D. We are a machine where children discover their passion and talents. And when children discover their passion and talents, something magically happens. They learn every day. So we have to create an environment where students with passion and talent can accelerate their learning. And if students don't have the passion and talent, they can choose other courses. This is changing the direction of education. And this should be taught by brave CEOs to create another mission for education. And once you have a mission, you do the next thing. You say, who has disruptive ideas? And you open an inspiration channel for Red Monkeys. And then sometimes you have a Red Monkey about flipped classroom or artificial, and I don't care what it is. And creators come in. And then you say as a CEO, we have a fantastic idea. It's coming not from our teachers. It's coming from another school. No, it's coming from our students. No, it's coming from students who are old. No, it's coming from technology. I don't care, but it helps to accomplish our new mission. And what you do then is, we have this bright idea. Who has the passion and talent to make it work? And then these pioneers come into the group. And you create incubation teams with passion and talent who need less, much more budget, who not asking is going to work, they will make it work. But what happens today? You have a disruptive idea, and the first question you ask, who has time? And then got all these sheep coming in, meh, meh, meh. And then you have a vacuum cleaner with the bag. This is not what you do. You make it work with you. And the moment it works, you know what the follower is going to say? Wow, couldn't they have shown it earlier? No, because it wasn't there yet. And then when you step in, do you know what the settler is going to say? The settler is going to say, well, I was always against it, but I always believed in it. He will change his color. So what is the thing? I think we need a disruption in organizational cultures. We need new missions. We need a Red Monkey channel. We have to combine Red Monkey 3D smarts in the right team at the right moment. So we need a change. Consensus model has to change into respectful conflict model. And I've learned one thing. Resistance to change is something we invented ourselves. It's not natural. Do you know why you get resistance to change? If you have a disruptive idea, and the CEO tells to everybody at the same time, now everybody has to accept the idea. It doesn't work. But when don't you have resistance to change? When you say, this is our mission, these people are going to produce it, and the moment it works, then you can step in. And the moment you can't do anything more, you can step in. So you have to build a system which is disruptive, but people can go with it organically. And you don't have any resistance to change anymore. You build a completely different organization. So the thing is, and I'm almost at the end, 54 seconds. This is really timing. Oh, I'm pleased with it. Okay, sorry. So what you have to do is, we have to break for Red Monkey. So I brought some stickers with me. You can have them. Put them on your whiteboard. Involve your students. Come up with disruptive ideas. Go to your boss and say, I need protection. But don't go to the status quo. Why? If you don't change the educational system, it's not going to be good. We need to change the educational system so we have people who work based on their passion and talent to solve all the problems we need. My generation has produced climate change, democracy in danger. We need a reboot of education. We need 3D heroes. I thank you for your attention. I brought with me a Red Monkey suit. So if you want to have a photo shoot, it's the moment. Thank you.